Good morning. Happy Sabbath, everybody. How are you? Are you blessed? Happy to be here celebrating another Sabbath? You know, there are those of us who look forward to celebrating a birthday every year because it means God has given us another 365 cycle and that He allowed us to see another chapter in our lives. But every Sabbath, every 7 days, you can celebrate Jesus and Him crucified, Jesus and the creation, and all of the things that God has led you through the course of the week. Is there anybody else here ready to celebrate with me? Amen. The Sabbath should definitely be a celebration. The Bible says, I will bless the Lord at all times. Psalm 34 says, His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make its boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear of it and be glad. And be what? And be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. David didn't want to do it by himself. I don't want to do it by myself. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. And let us exalt His name. How? Together. Together.
Sanctuary. Praise Him in His mighty firmament. Praise Him for His mighty acts. Praise Him according to His excellent greatness. Praise Him with the sound of the trumpet. Praise Him with the lute and the harp. Praise Him with the timbrel and the dance. Praise Him with string instruments and flutes. Praise Him with loud cymbals. Praise Him with clashing cymbals. Let everything that has breath. I said, let everything that has breath. Let everything that has breath praise ye the Lord. Father, Father in heaven, in the name of Jesus, we are just excited to be in the house of the Lord today to give you praise, glory, and honor. Father, we're thankful for what you have took us through, what you have brought us through, and brought us to this wonderful, blessed Sabbath where we can celebrate the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. We ask now in the name of Jesus that your Holy Spirit might abide in this place, that you would move in this room. And Father, we pray that as we leave this place today, as we worship you in spirit as well as in truth, and when we leave this place, may we say that it was good to be in the house of the Lord. We thank you, we praise you, and we love you. In Christ's name we pray, amen.
Continue in my word, then are ye my disciple indeed. And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. They answered him, we be Abraham's seed, and were never in bondage to any man. How saying that ye shall be made free?
Amen, amen, amen. This is the part of the service where you could have worshiped in the introit, but now all of us have an opportunity to participate in this portion of the service. This is the tithe and offering. Amen. Amen. This is the opportunity where we can give back to God just a portion, just a small part of what God has given to us. Has God been good to you? Has God been good to you? Oh, come on now. God has been better than good to you. I see you y'all looking good out there, so I know he's been good to you. You got your nice suits on and your pretty dresses, so that means God has been good to you. Amen. God woke you up this morning, put you in your right mind, so he has been blessing you. Some of y'all coming up in here in these fancy cars, so God, I know God's been extra, extra good to some of y'all. And so God only asks that we just return to him a portion, a small part of what he's given to us. You should see on your screen several ways that you can give through our South Nashville SDA website. You can give through Cash App. There is PayPal. And, of course, there is good old-fashioned snail mail. Snail mail. And we have the deacons coming around at this time to pick up offering and tithe in the sanctuary. I want to remind everybody today that God wants us to be faithful. And he wants us to be faithful, not just to tithe in the tithe, but also in the offering. Because did you know that to really show your faith is the offering? Is the offering. Because what happens is, see, God, when we return the tithe, that's just giving back to God what we already owe him. God loaned us $20, so we're giving him $20 back. You don't really show faith until you put in an extra something in the offering. Because that shows, God, I really appreciate what you have done for me. I have one more lady in the back there. Thank you so much. And so let's be faithful to the Lord, not just in our tithe, but also in our offerings. Because God has been faithful to us. We have to return the favor and be faithful to him. Let us pray. Father in heaven, in the name of Jesus, we thank you so much for the opportunity and the privilege to give back to you just a small portion of what you have blessed us with. Now, Father, we're asking right now that you would take this tithe and this offering, and we pray that you would bless it. We pray that you would stretch it, and we pray that it might be used to further the gospel, not just here in the city of Antioch, but also around the world. We pray that you would bless those who had to give, bless those who had not to give but wanted to give. And we pray as well that you would convict and convert the hearts of those who have to give but chose not to. We thank you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. God is here. So let's prepare to talk to him in prayer. There is a sweet anointing in the sanctuary. There is a stillness in the atmosphere. Come and lay down the burdens you
lay down all the burdens that you carry. Come lay down all of the burdens that you carry. In Galatians chapter 6, the Bible talks about how there are certain burdens that God's people are to carry. And then it goes on to talk about there are also certain burdens that God's people are not to carry. And so there are some things that God expects us to carry on our own. It's like putting on a backpack with a few crayons in the bag. And so there are some things that we are meant to carry on our own, and God expects us to carry them on our own. Because the text says to carry your own burdens. But then it also says to not carry your burdens. Because there are some things that are so heavy, that it is impossible for us to carry them. And so sometimes we as finite individuals, what we do is, we try our best to carry these burdens that God never meant for us to carry. And so we're pulling and we're dragging and we're doing everything we can to try to get this burden from one place to another. And in the process, we're killing ourselves. Because God said, I don't want you to carry that burden. He tells us in the Bible that we are to bring all of our carries and our cares and our burdens. Come unto me, all who are weary and are heavy burdened, and I will give you rest. And so we don't have to be tired carrying it, because God promises to carry it himself and give us rest. Somebody came in here today with a burden. You came in here today and you've been putting something on your back and it's been weighing you down and you can't move. You're tired. You're worn out. You're stressed. And God says, I want you to give it to me. Got a burden today. I want you to come forward. We're going to pray for God to take that burden and to carry that burden for you. I want you to come. Come lay down all of the burdens at his feet. You know, what's interesting is that all of those burdens, see, the thing sometimes about carrying the burdens and laying down the burdens, sometimes we have a habit of laying it down, and then as soon as we leave, we get up, we pick it back up. We pick it back up and we take it with us again, or try to take it with us. But God wants us to take the burden, to leave it at his feet, and leave it. We talked earlier in Sabbath school about how we have a habit of not believing that God's going to take care of it. And so what we do is we try our best to, you know, he didn't fix it yet, and so let me go and try to fix it myself. God desperately wants you to just leave it to him. And so as far as possible, let's kneel, let's stand, whatever your prayer posture is, you can sit, but we're going to call upon the name of the Lord. Father in heaven, in the name of Jesus, we are humbled by the fact that we get to, first of all, kneel before a holy God. We're humbled by the fact that the same God who put the stars in orbit, the same God who created something out of nothing, the same God who separated the firmaments, Lord, the same God who put the fish in the sea, the same God who speaks and things come into existence, things come into place, that same God who sits high in heaven is willing to hear our humble petitions. And so, Father, we just pause this morning, Father, just to, first of all, just to say thank you. Because we feel so unworthy. So unworthy. Father, we thank you for just being able to listen. If nothing else, that you are able to listen to us. You are willing to listen. And Father, we are even more excited that not only will you listen to us, not only will you hear us, but you promise to answer us. And so, Father, because we recognize that we are an unholy people, as we approach you this morning, we first ask for forgiveness of our sins. Lord, we ask that you would remove from us anything that is unholy, anything that is not like you, anything that may prevent our prayers from being heard. Lord, we're asking that you would take it out of us right now at this moment so that our prayers don't stop at the ceiling. Father, I don't know what your children have come to the altar for today, but you do. Lord, before we came up here today, Lord, you read our hearts. You read our minds. And so, Lord, you already know what we stand in need of. But, Lord, just like we as humans, Lord, we want to hear it. Just like my wife wants to hear that I love her, that I love her, Lord, you also want to hear what we stand in need of. You want us to recognize the fact that you are the only one that can do something about our situation, that can answer our prayers. And so, Father, we come today as humbly as we know how, asking for you to hear and for you to answer our petitions. Lord, some of us are asking for healing. Some of us are asking for a financial strength, Lord. Some of us are asking for relationships to be restored. Some of us are asking for marriages to be restored. Some of us are asking for peace because we're dealing with so much that is going on around us. Some of us are asking for peace, Lord, because we're having to deal with sickness and death, Lord. Lord, there's so much going on, Lord. But we bring it all to you. And Father, we're believing by faith that whatever it is we lay at your feet today, even though it may not be answered in the time frame that we expect it to be answered, we believe by faith that you will answer it. Lord, you have a perfect record. You have never failed, ever. And so, Lord, we are believing that whatever it is that we bring to you, you will work it out. And you will work it out according to your will and in your timing. But Lord, we also have to just pause to just ask, Lord, that whatever it is that you're allowing us to go through at this time, Lord, that you would give us spiritual eyes to see how you are trying to speak to us through that situation. Father, in every trial, you want us to learn something. You want to show us something. And so, Father, we pray that our hearts, our spiritual eyes will be open to hear exactly what you want us to see and what you want us to learn. And Father, when it's all said and done, when it's all said and done, when it's all said and done, when you meet every need, when you answer every prayer, when you bring us through every trial, we pray that we will remember from whence cometh our help. Our help only comes from you. Help us to remember to give you all the glory, all the praise, and all the honor that you are deserving of, because you are worthy to be lifted up. We thank you and we praise you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen, amen, and amen.
He is here. God is here to break. Thank you.
right here. Can you feel him in the room? Can you feel the power of the Holy Spirit moving right now on you and on your situation? Declare it. You know, the Bible says that there are those of us who have a form of godliness, but deny the power thereof. But you know, Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit, and God have dunamis power. That is just immeasurable power that we can tap into. They don't deny the power that they have. All we have to do is just tap into the source. When you're feeling weak and your battery is drained, your faith is low, your spirits are heavy, just tap into the power of Jesus. We're going to sing All Hail the Power of Jesus' Mighty Name. Jesus spoke things and they became so. He said a word and people were healed. He turned mud into clay with spittle and he touched and put it on somebody's eyes, and the power of Jesus healed someone's vision. He could speak, he could touch, he could heal just by his presence. But his very name, just his name alone, has power. You're dealing with something and there's just darkness in your atmosphere. Say the name of Jesus and that'll bring some light, and demons will have to flee. Just his name alone has power. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall.
Let every kindred, every tongue on this terrain.
So lift your spirits. Be encouraged, my brother. Be encouraged, my sister. He still loves you. Yes, he does. He still holds you right there in the palm of his hands. And I'm so glad that when I don't feel it, that I know he's reaching down wherever I am so that he can lift me up. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. Has he lifted anybody else? Has he brought you through anything? Let's sing. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me, singing glory, hallelujah. Jesus lifted me. You can stand on your feet. You can clap your hands. We're going to celebrate Jesus today.
So glad you're in my life.
I'm so glad you came to save us.
Say it again, Lord, I lift your name.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises.
I'm so glad, God.
I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us.
So you came from heaven to earth. Is anybody glad that God came from heaven to earth just to save us?
To earth, to show the way.
And
from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high.
Say, Lord.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life.
Anybody glad about that this morning?
I'm so glad you came to save us.
Say it again. Lord, I lift your name on high.
Lord, I lift your name on high.
Lord,
I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life.
Yes, Lord. I'm so glad.
I'm so glad you came to save us.
So you came from heaven.
You came from heaven to earth to show the way. From the earth to the cross, my debt you paid. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high.
You came from heaven, God.
You came from heaven to earth to show the way. And from the earth to the cross, my debt you paid. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high.
Lord, I lift your name.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Your name on high. We say, love lifted me. Love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Love lifted me.
Everybody glad that God's love lifted them.
Amen. Yeah.
No matter what we're going through, no matter what trials and what tribulations we face, we know that the love of our Savior covers us, it keeps us, it sustains us.
Yes,
so
yes.
We can say, I was sinking deep in sin, far from a peaceful shore,
very steeply stained within. Seeking to rise no more, but the master of the sea heard my despairing cry. From the water he lifted me, now safe am I.
His
love lifted me. Yeah.
So our response this morning, God, is
I love you. I love you. I love you, Lord, today, because you care for me in such a special way. That's why I praise you.
Yes, God.
I lift you up and I magnify your name. Oh, that's why my heart is filled with praise.
Do I have any praises today?
So Father, we say, I love you. I love you. I love you, Lord, today.
My heart, my mind,
my heart, my mind,
my soul belongs to you.
You paid the price for me, Lord,
for me.
You died on Calvary, and that's why I praise you.
That's so God.
I lift you up, Father.
Say it again, Lord, I love you, I love you, Lord.
I love you, I love you, I love you, Lord, today, because you care for me, because you care for me
in such a special way, God,
in such a special way, and that's why I praise you.
Yes, God,
I lift you up, Lord, and I magnify your name. Oh, that's why my heart is filled with praise.
That's why
my heart is filled with praise.
Didn't have food on my table, but God, somehow you provided for me. That's why my heart is filled with praise.
That's why my heart is filled with praise.
Didn't have gas money, but God, you made a way, and I made it. That's safely, God. That's why my heart is filled with praise.
My heart is filled with praise.
They're shooting and killing, but God, my children are still alive today. That's why my heart is filled with praise.
My heart is filled with praise.
I was a sinner, a wretch undone, but you died for me, Jesus. That's why my heart is filled with praise, God. Yeah. It's filled with praise. I love you, Lord. I worship and adore you, God. That's why my heart is filled with praise.
I praise your name, oh Lord.
That's why my heart is filled with praise.
You thought I was worth saving, so you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping.
Yeah.
So you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for. So you sacrificed your life so I could be free, so I could be whole. And I would tell everyone I know. You thought I was worth saving.
Is anybody glad this morning? Yeah.
So you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping.
You didn't throw me out, God, but you kept me right there.
So you cleaned me up
inside. You thought I was to die for. Yes, you did, oh Lord. So you sacrificed your life so I could be free, so I could be whole. And I will tell everyone I know. Lift your voice and sing it with me. We say, hallelujah. Father, we declare glory to the God who changed, to the God who changed my life. Yeah, yeah. And I will praise you forever. I'll worship you, God, forever. I'll give you glory forever and ever because I am free, because I am whole. And I will tell, I'll tell everyone. We say hallelujah, 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 Lord. We say glory, glory, glory to the God who changed my life, who changed my life. Yeah, yeah. And I will praise you forever. I'll worship you, Lord. I'll give you glory forever. Because I am free. Because I am whole. And I will tell everyone I know. You thought I was worth saving. Yes, oh God. So you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping.
Hallelujah.
So you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for. So you sacrificed your life so I can be free, so I can be whole. And I will tell. You came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping. Glory to your name, Father.
So
you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for. So you made the sacrifice, Lord, so I can be free, so I can be whole. And I will tell Lord, hallelujah.
Glory to the God.
Glory.
Glory to the God
who changed my life. Lord, I will praise you, Lord. I'll worship you, Jesus. I'll give you glory. I want you to know today that you are free, you are whole, so go and tell everyone you know, say I am free,
yes, declare it.
Free by the blood of the Lamb of Jesus Christ, I am free, no longer bound, but chains are broken off of me, I am whole. And I can tell everyone I know. Everyone I know. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. It won't work. No weapon formed against me.
Somebody need to declare that this morning.
Shall prosper. It won't work. No weapon
against me shall prosper. Stand by his word, Lord, he will come through. I say that God will do what he said he will do. He will stand by his word. He will come through. No weapon formed against me shall. Oh, it won't work. No weapon against me shall prosper.
No, no,
it won't work. I know God will do it. He will.
For those who are visiting us for the first time, welcome to South Nashville. You see, sometimes you got to allow the Holy Spirit to move. Because the thing is, you don't know what folk have been through.
That's right.
You don't know what people are going through. What did it say? You don't know my story? You don't know my story? And so you don't know why I may shout or I may stand or I may raise my hands, I may clap. You don't know what I've been through. And so what happens is sometimes we look at people strange because they don't worship or they don't express themselves the way that we do. But you see, the we learned last year that when you look at the Bible, the Bible talks about that word, hallelujah. See, in the original language, that word hallelujah actually means to act a fool for God. Y'all don't hear me today. I'm talking about the literal definition of it, means to act a fool for God. But see, we've been, the powers that be have told us that acting a fool ain't right. That's what the heathens do. See, I'm torn this morning because I spent all week working on a sermon. I spent all week working on a sermon. I'm up this morning, okay? The kids downstairs eating. I'm upstairs trying to finish this sermon for this morning. And so I'm sitting here and I'm listening and I'm just feeling like the Lord is saying, no, that ain't where I want you to go. And so this morning I'm torn because sometimes the Lord wants to speak to you in a different way. And I just feel today that somebody, it may be one person in here, needs to hear something that's going to speak to their hearts, specifically in what they're going through. Let's pray. Father in heaven, in the name of Jesus, I need you to speak through me to your people. Somebody needs to hear a word from you today. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. If you have your Bibles, I'm going to ask that you would stand with me. Turn to the book of Luke, chapter 22. Luke, chapter 22. We're going to begin verse 31. So for those who are in the back, you're going to have to change that slide and everything that we had for today. Luke chapter 22, verse 31, the Bible says, and the Lord said, Simon, Simon, you can put your name right there where it says Simon. Plug in your name. Indeed, Satan has asked for you that he may sift you as wheat. Then Jesus says in verse 32, but I have prayed for you. But I have prayed for you that your faith should not fail. That your faith should not fail. That you would hold on and not let go. And when you have returned to me, when you have returned to me, I don't want you to forget what I've done for you. Don't forget how I have strengthened you. But I want you, he says, to strengthen your brethren. I just want to talk today on when Jesus prays. You may be seated. When Jesus prays. Our story today takes place during the time of the Last Supper. The disciples have been arguing about who will be the greatest. Who will be the greatest? When Jesus begins to explain to them that if you really want to be great, you must be willing to serve. Jesus then says something in verse 28 that I believe sets the stage for the text that we just read in verses 31 through 33. In verse 28, Jesus says, "But you are those who have continued with me in my trials." You see, in spite of their imperfections, the disciples had been loyal to Jesus through everything that Jesus had been through up until this point. And so Christ knew that because of their loyalty, because they stayed close to Jesus, the devil would not make their next few years, their next few moments easy. And so that's why Jesus says in verse 31, indeed, Satan has asked for you that he may sift you as wheat. Did you know that when you choose to be a follower of the Most High God, when you choose to follow Jesus, there is not a day that goes by that the devil does not ask for you? Not a day. Not a day. Did you also know that every day, the devil, Satan, puts stumbling blocks in your way to discourage you and to distract you from not just following the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings, but also from being everything and everything that God has called for you to be? Every day. Every day. And so that bill that came in your mail this week unexpectedly, the same one that caused you to have to question whether or not you were going to be faithful today. Hello, somebody. That was of the devil. That coworker that you ran into this past week that you were about this close to cussing out. You ain't got to say amen. Just say, ouch. That was the devil. The time that car broke down right when you were just about to spend that extra couple dollars you had, that was the devil. It was the devil. All of the challenges that come causing you to question the sovereignty and the faithfulness of God, those are obstacles that the devil throws at you to move you intentionally from where God would have for you to be. They come from the devil. And so it's no accident, beloved, it's no accident that right now some of y'all having marital problems. Yeah, mm-hmm. It's no accident. It's no accident that every time you try to be faithful to God, something else comes up. Anybody with me here today? Every time. It's no accident. Every single time you try to do your best to be faithful to the Lord, something else comes up. It's no accident, because what the devil does is the devil is intent on every single day testing you. You see, in the New Testament, there are two words that are translated test or tempt. There is the Greek word dokimazo. Dokimazo. Can you say that? Dokimazo, which means to test with the intention of strengthening. Test with the intention of strengthening. And this is what God does in order to build us up. He tests us in order to strengthen us. Okay? For instance, in 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 13, the Bible says that when Jesus comes, the fire will test each one's work of what sort it is. So God tests us in order to build us up. Then there is the word perasmo, which means to test with a view towards destruction. Destruction. And this is what the devil does. He tests in order to destroy you. For instance, in Matthew chapter 4, the Bible says that the devil tests Jesus or tempts Jesus in the wilderness. And he does this in order to see Jesus fail. And so all of these situations, all of these trials the devil puts you through, all of these things that he throws at you, the devil does it not because he wants to see you strengthened, not because he wants to see you prosper, but he does it in order to see you fail. Because the devil's whole intent is for you to turn away from God. To turn away from God. And when you think about it, it sounds discouraging. That these things, sometimes these things come in order to turn you away from the Lord. But beloved, there's a blessing. There's a blessing in it that even though the devil is doing everything he can to tear you down, he can only do, hear me, saints, he can only do what the devil, what the Father allows him to do. He can only do what the Father allows him to do. Even though the devil's only reason for testing you is to bring you down, he can only do what the Father says that he can do. Because if you notice, the text says Satan has asked for you. He's asked, which means that he got to get permission first. Got to get permission. You see, it's like if you ever see any of my children with phones. They know they're not allowed to play with daddy's phone. Not allowed to play with daddy's phone. They can play with mama's phone. So if you ever see them with a phone that belongs to daddy, it has to be because daddy has given them the okay. Because daddy said it's okay. In the same way, the devil cannot do anything to you. He can't do anything to you unless he gets permission from the Father. Unless he gets permission from the Father. Unless the Lord allows it. That means the devil cannot kick you out of your house unless God said, okay. It's okay. The devil can't allow you to go through anything. The devil cannot do anything to you. Nothing. Whatever it is you're going through right now, it's because God said, okay. Okay. And some of us are going through some stuff right now, and we're wondering why. We're wondering why. The reason is God said, okay. God said, okay. You got to understand that the devil cannot do anything to you unless God has signed off, unless God has checked that box. That means the only power that the devil has is the power that has been given to him by God. That means he can't do whatever he wants. Some of y'all in some stuff right now, you think that the devil is doing whatever he wants. And he ain't doing whatever he wants. He's doing what God has allowed him to do. What God has allowed him to do. So whatever situation you're in, before you went into it, the devil had to sit down with God to discuss whether or not he could put you through it. Whether or not he could put you through it. So they actually had a conversation about whether you were strong enough to take whatever it is that the devil was about to take you through. They had a conversation. But not only did they talk about whether you were strong enough to take it, but they also talked about how long you were going to be in that thing. Lord have mercy. They actually had a discussion about how long you were going to be in it. And if you were going to be in it by yourself, or if your family was going to be in that thing with you, hello somebody. All of this was discussed before you actually went into the situation. So the devil didn't just throw that thing on you by accident without God knowing. It didn't happen by accident. But you see, some of y'all don't believe. So let's look at the Bible. In Job chapter 1, it says that there was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job. This man was blameless, upright, feared God, and shunned men. Then in verse 6, it says that now there was a day when the sons of God came. The sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came among them. And the Lord said to Satan, "From where do you come?" So Satan answered the Lord and said, "From going to and fro on the earth and from walking back and forth on it." Then the Lord said to Satan, "My Lord, have mercy." Then the Lord said to Satan, have you considered Sister Sheila Moore? Have you considered Luke Robinson? Have you considered Gregory Valentine? Have you considered? And what he's doing, God is putting your name out there. God is putting your name out there. It says that there is none like him in all of Antioch. All of Antioch. Blameless, upright, fears God, shuns man, shuns evil. So Satan answered the Lord and said, "Does this saint of yours, this child of God of yours, do they serve God for nothing?" That's what he asked. Does Job fear God for nothing? That's what the text says. "Have you not made a hedge around him or her? Have you not provided for him or her? Did you not give him this nice cushy job, this nice house, this car? Gave them good health? Did you not? You have blessed the work of their hands, and his possessions have increased in the land. But now, I see the devil don't believe. The devil said, "Look, stretch out your hand and touch all that he has, and he will surely curse you to your face." This is what the devil says. And the Lord said to Satan, "Behold, everything that she has, everything that he has is in your power. Only do not lay a hand on his person." So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord. Mercy. So the Bible is clear that before Satan could do anything to Job, he literally had a meeting with God to talk about you. Mercy. To talk about you and about what he's about to take you through. Now look at what it says in chapter 2 and verse 3. After God allows Satan to cause Job to lose everything. And this time I'm going to read it from the Message Bible. The text says, "Then God said to Satan, 'Have you noticed my friend Job?'" My friend. Ain't nothing like being a friend to God. Come on now. "There is no one quite like him, is there? Honest and true to his word, totally devoted to God and hating evil. This brother still has a firm grip on his integrity. You tried to trick me into destroying him, but it didn't work." So once again, it's Satan that causes Job to go through what Job would go through. But even though Satan is the one who puts him through it, he could not do it without first talking to the Father. What happens is this is not always what we like to hear. That God is the one who basically allows Satan to throw us under the bus. We don't want to hear that. So what you're saying, Pastor, is that God put my name out there. I was minding my own business. And you, God, let's be real, because some of us are like that. You, God, allowed me to go through this. You ain't got to say amen. You can say ouch, because some of y'all have been praying that. Why me, God? Why am I going through it? You're allowing me to go through this. We've said the same thing. Why me? That's what Job was saying. He says, because that's basically what he does. Because remember, it was God who said to Satan, have you considered my servant Job? So it's not what we want to hear, especially depending on what we're going through at the time. If it's something small, it's no big deal. But if it's something major, then we get to that point and we don't see an exit route. See, that's the reality is, to be honest, we can take it sometimes when we see a light at the end of the tunnel. But what happens when you don't see a light at the end of the tunnel? What happens when you just in the dark and it seems like forever? Forever. And what we do is we start to question God. Why me? I thought you loved me. But to be honest, this is the encouraging part. It's encouraging that Satan has to have a conversation with God before putting me through anything. Because it tells me that God is not asleep at the wheel. It tells me that God is still sitting high and looking low. It tells me that God is still on the throne and he is aware of every single thing that I am going through. He's aware. So God ain't up there asleep. He's not asleep. He knows what you're going through. Tells me that the reason God allowed me to go through whatever I'm going through is because God knows that you can take it. God knows that you can take it. And the reason he knows you can take it is because by the time that thing comes to you, whatever it is, God will have given you everything you need to get through it. By the time you get to it, he would have downloaded everything you need to be able to make it through that thing. So you thinking right now, I don't know how I'm gonna make it through it. God has already made provisions for that. Already made provisions, my Lord. So we think, I don't know. I mean, this is hard. But God has already said, look, you can test him, you can test her, because I've already put in her what they need to make it through. See, that's why God can say, have you considered my servant Job? Because God already knew beforehand, because remember, he knows the beginning from the end. He already knew beforehand what Job was going to go through. He already, listen, God takes, the devil comes and he says, look, is God, can I speak now? Go ahead, Satan. What do you have to say? I was thinking about, if you don't mind, I was thinking about doing something to James today. And so the devil, Satan is like, okay, this is what I want to do. And the devil's like, God is like, nah, take some of that off. Okay? So he comes and he has this boatload of trials that he wants to take you through. And so the father says, no, take some of that off. I need you to take two things off, all right? Those other three things are good. They're good. You can take them through that. You can take them through that. And so what happens is this thing is encouraging because it lets us know that God, even though it may be a lot, God already knows what he is putting in us. But let me tell you the best part of this. The best part is that because God knows the devil has asked for you, and because he knows that by yourself you can't handle whatever it is the devil is going to throw at you, because he knows your inadequacies and your shortcomings and that it's easy for you to get discouraged, it's easy for you to want to give up, because he knows, the Bible says that God intercedes, that Jesus intercedes for you. I don't know, maybe this is going over somebody's head today. Jesus says in verse 32, but I have prayed for you. Lord, have mercy. But I have prayed for you. Now, for those of you all, who know anything about the power of prayer, this is the part when you see only the folk who know about the power of prayer shout. Okay? Because this is the part where you shout. Because if you've ever seen God come through when we send up, you know how, Lord, can you just please save me for what I'm going through? We send up these little mamby-pamby prayers, and we expect God to move. We expect him to move. How much more powerful and how much more of a guarantee is it for your prayer to be answered when Jesus is praying for you? See, we got some prayer warriors in the church. Praise the Lord for you. I want you to pray for me. But ain't nothing like Jesus praying for you. See, listen, this is the thing. See, if you pray for me, I hope it gets answered. I hope it gets answered. But if Jesus prays for me, that thing is a done deal. It's done. Because, this is the exciting part. Because, see, the one who's doing the praying is the same one who's doing the answering. Oh, Lord Jesus. I'm going to get excited by myself. He's answering. Have mercy. Whew, man. The same one who's going to ask is the same one who's going to answer. So I'm guaranteed. Check this out. In verse 31, where he says that Satan has asked for you, in the original language, in the Greek, the word you is in the plural, meaning you all. So when Jesus says Satan has asked for you, he's talking to all of the disciples. Satan has asked for you all. But when you get to verse 32, where he says, I have prayed for you, the you in verse 32 is in the singular. Oh, it's in the singular because he's speaking specifically to Peter. That means even though he knew that Satan had asked for them as a body of believers at South Nashville, Jesus had prayed for each one of them individually. Individually. That means even though Jesus is concerned, see, Jesus cares about all of us. Prays for all of us. Thinks about all of us. But you know what? He is specifically concerned about me. He's specifically concerned about you. He prayed for you. That means he's interceding for each of us as individuals. So he's not just, Father, can you do some stuff for South Nashville? He ain't looking at it like that. He's going and he's taking your name, Jasmine Vasquez. This is what I need for you to do for her. And because the one that's asking the prayer, saying the prayer is also God, he's saying, this is what I need you to do. He's like, okay. Come on, man. That means he's not just praying that God will bless this church, but he's praying that God will bless you individually. You. He's praying for you. He's praying for you individually that you might get the victory over whatever temptations, whatever struggles, whatever addictions, whatever trials that you're going through. He's praying that you will be delivered from sickness and disease, from all of the things that have you bound. He's praying just as much for you and your personal situation as he is for all of us as a body of believers. He's praying for all of us individually. And I need you, saints, I need you to get this, because sometimes we question, we wonder whether or not God is really concerned about us as individuals. We wonder. Because we see God, it seems as though God is moving in everybody else's life. Seems like he's answering their prayers. But when I turn around, I'm still going through some stuff. Why me? And so we question whether or not God hears our prayers and our petitions. We question whether or not God is really going to answer our prayers. But I want to encourage somebody today. I want to let you know that not only does God know what you're going through, but God hears you. And he's prayed for you. He's prayed for you. Because sometimes we look at everybody else and we wonder, we question, let's just be real. Let's be real. You shared your prayer request with me. I shared mine with you, and I see yours is answered. Mm-hmm. And I'm still waiting. I'm still waiting. But beloved, I want to assure you today that God loves you too much to leave you out there by yourself. Amen. Loves you too much. You see, when he says to Peter, Simon, Simon, I have prayed for you, what he was actually saying is, not only have I prayed for you, but I love you. I love you. See, because in Hebrew, the repetition of a person's name is a method of communicating intimacy. Intimacy. For example, in 1 Samuel 3, verse 10, when God calls Samuel inside the temple, he repeats his name. In Genesis 22, 11, when Abraham is about to sacrifice Isaac, he does the same thing. He repeats his name. And there are other instances throughout Scripture, but the point is when God repeats a person's name, he is communicating intimacy. So when Jesus says, Simon, Simon, he's saying that he and Simon have this personal, intimate relationship, and because they have this intimate relationship, he is praying for him and he loves him. And Jesus is saying the same thing to you today. The same thing. Because I love you, I have prayed for you. Because we have this intimate relationship, because I don't want to see you fall, I pray for you. I pray for you. Now, what I thought was interesting is that the text doesn't say, I'm praying for you.
Pray.
It doesn't say, I'm praying for you.
Yes, sir.
The text says, Jesus says, I have prayed for you. Meaning past tense. Now, when I first read this, I thought to myself, why does Jesus say, I have prayed for you instead of I'm praying for you? Why does he say, I prayed for you instead of I'm praying for you? Because it makes me think that the situation isn't important enough for Jesus to keep praying. Because you know how we are. We will pray for somebody for a couple of days or even a couple of weeks, and if the Lord doesn't answer the prayer, then oops. Sorry. We forget. And so I'm wondering, why does he say, I have prayed for you? And then I realized, first of all, that because he's Jesus, every prayer that Jesus prays is going to get through. Every prayer. So he's not like us having, you know, we got to keep praying. We got to keep praying and asking and asking and asking. We got to be like Luke 18, a persistent widow. Keep asking the Father, hoping that he hears us. But when Jesus prays the first time, when Jesus prays one time for you, it's done. He does not have to pray anymore. He doesn't have to pray anymore. And so that's why the thing is in the past tense. I realized that the reason he says, I have prayed for you, is because Jesus is he's a proactive God. What does it mean to be proactive? So Jesus doesn't wait until you get kicked out of your house to start praying for you. He doesn't wait till your trial comes. He begins to pray. See, the only reason you're still alive, you still got your right mind right now, is because Jesus prayed for you in the past before that thing came up. Because if he didn't pray for you, you'd be out there somewhere. Have mercy. So he doesn't wait until your life has become a shambles to begin praying for you. Jesus begins interceding on your behalf before the Father, before that thing even comes up. Before the devil throws that thing at you, he's been praying that your faith fail not. That your faith fail not, and that you would trust in the promises of God. I'm closing. So he's praying that you would believe that no weapon formed against you shall prosper. He's praying that you would believe that he would supply all of your riches, all of your needs according to his riches and glory. He's praying that you believe that he who began a good work in you, and you will finish it until the day of Jesus Christ. He's praying that you believe that no temptation has overtaken you except such as is common to man, but that he is faithful. Who is faithful? God is faithful. And will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you're able, but with the temptation will make a way of escape that you will be able to bear it. Amen. So before you go through that thing, before you go through it, before you went through it, Christ has prayed that you would believe, that you would stand on the promises of God, and that you would trust that no matter what you go through, everything's going to be all right. That's what he prayed for. Now I want you to think about that for a moment. I want you to think about the fact that right now the devil is having a conversation with God about all the stuff he's about to put you through. And because Christ knows that that thing is coming, he's already started praying that you not be discouraged and that you not be afraid and that your faith fail not. Beloved, even at this moment, Christ is praying that when that situation comes up, not only will you stand on what he promises he'll do, but he's praying that you'll remember what he's already done. He's praying that you'll remember all the times you were ready to give up because you thought that it was too much. He's praying that you remember that in the end, God came through. He's praying that you not look at the severity of your circumstances, but trust in the faithfulness of your God. Your God. Beloved, I don't know what you're going through right now. But I would encourage you today, remind you today that Christ knows. Christ knows. Christ knows. In fact, not only does he know, but he was the one that allowed you to go through it. But before he allowed that thing to come on you, he prayed for you. Before he allowed it to come upon you, he prayed, past tense, for you. Which means that no matter what you're going through, you're going to be all right. You will be okay. That's my appeal today. It's for that man, woman, boy, or girl. You in the midst of something right now. You are going through something right now that has really just been wearing you down. It's been this load, this heavy weight. And to be honest, you've been trying to think to yourself, how am I going to make it through this thing? How am I going to make it through? And even at times, you have questioned, you have wondered if God is really with you. You've wondered because you don't see any appearances of God moving in your life. Things may just be getting worse and worse and worse, and you're wondering, how long, Lord? How long? If that's you today, you're going through something. You're in the midst of something. And you need to say, Lord, you need to say today, Lord, I need the strength to make it through this thing. I need the strength to be able to believe, the faith to be able to believe that you have prayed for me and I will make it through. That's you. I want you to come forward today. We're going to pray for you. I want to pray for you. Come. Come. I don't know what you're going through, but he wants to bring you through it. He promises to bring you through it. He promises. Never lost the battle. Never lost the fight. 1,000,000,000,000. We can't even imagine what God wants to do. You will make it through. You will make it through. You will make it through. You will. Today in Sabbath school, we were talking about Exodus chapter 14 and how the Bible talks about how the beginning of the chapter, God tells Moses to tell the children of Israel that you're getting ready to go through something. I'm getting ready to take you through something. And as they're going through it, God tells them, he says, as a matter of fact, before he tells them that I'm going to take you through something, and then he says, I'm going to be honored and glorified at the end. But then right afterwards, they begin to go through it. They begin to go through the wilderness. They're running from the Egyptians, and the Red Sea is in front of them, and Pharaoh and his army are right behind them. And so they're in between a rock and a hard place. And in their minds, they can't imagine the sea being parted. They can't imagine something impossible being done. But the thing is, God specializes in the impossible. That's his specialty. And so even when it doesn't seem like he's going to make a way, see, he does some of his best work when your back is against the wall. So I am waiting. You got to just stand there and stand. The text says to stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. You got to just stand still and watch and wait to see how God's going to move and how he's going to part your Red Sea. Father in heaven, in the name of Jesus, Lord, you know what we're going through right now. You know what the devil has allowed us, or better yet, what the devil has placed upon us. And Lord, you know that the devil's intention is to tempt us, to test us, and to sift us like wheat. His intention is to see us fail and to see us fall. But you, Lord, have come to strengthen us. And so, Lord, I'm just asking right now in the name of Jesus, I don't know what your children are going through today, right now. And I don't know what their wilderness experience is. I don't know what the devil has thrown at them, Lord. But I'm asking right now that you would encourage your people today, Lord, that they would stand on your promises. That they will look back at everything you've done for them in the past, Lord. This is not the first Red Sea that has stood behind them, in front of them. Oh, we pray that you will help us to look back at what you've done in the past and help us to be encouraged at what you can do in the future. Lord, I'm asking right now that you would be with each and every individual, that you would address each one of us individually, that you would speak to each one of our prayers, Lord. And Father, we pray most importantly that when we leave this altar, when we leave this church, when we leave this place today, that we will leave in peace. Help us, Lord, to leave in peace, knowing that you have prayed for us and that it is done. We thank you, Lord. We praise you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen and amen. You may be seated. God bless you. As Sister Gaines comes up for the benediction, I want to remind everybody that immediately after the service, we will be giving out groceries. And so we encourage you to stay back. Here at South Nashville, we believe in being the hands and feet of Jesus. And so we will be giving out groceries in our community today from out in front of the church. So we encourage you to stay back as we do service for the Lord.
Were you all blessed by the message we received today? Praise God. That was a beautiful message. And the take home for me, it doesn't matter what the devil puts us through, he can't do nothing that the Lord will not allow. And also, if the devil wants to sift us as wheat every day, we can know that Jesus has already prayed for us. Hallelujah. Praise his holy name. Let us stand for the benediction. And before we do the benediction, I just want to remind everyone that next Sabbath on July 23rd, we will have a potluck in commemoration of our pastor, our first lady, and his family will be leaving us to go to a land far away. And we're going to miss him. And so I want everybody to come in and show up and invite friends, invite family, so that we can share this time together as we fellowship and send them off with a lot of love and encouragement. Now for the benediction, let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for another opportunity to come into your house of prayer and worship, to lift up your holy name, Lord God, and to give you all the honor in praise, in song, in testimony, and in prayer. And Lord, we just ask that you go with us as we venture out back to our destinations. We want to be sure that you are with us, leading and guiding us all along the way. And now, may the strength of God sustain us. May the power of God preserve us. May the hands of God protect us, may the way of God direct us, and may the love of God go with us this day, this holy Sabbath day, now and forevermore. In Jesus' holy and precious name we pray, amen.
Before we leave, as we're preparing to leave, last Sabbath I mentioned Sister Renee Odom. Mentioned that Sister Renee Odom over here to my left, your right, had a book out. And the reason why I wanted to mention that book is because I mentioned the fact that there are gifts in the body of Christ. There are gifts in the church, and we want to be able to recognize those gifts. And so Sister Renee, I mentioned Sister Renee Odom wrote a book. And I also mentioned that Sister Diane Brown here wrote a children's book as well. Mommy, Can I Look Like You? And it is a book about us. Amen, somebody. Amen, somebody. So I want to encourage, and she also has another book that is coming out as well. But I just want to just promote our church members. When God is using them, we want to be able to also show that God is using them by supporting them as well. Amen. Amen. At this time, you are dismissed. God bless you.